Hello, hello, and welcome back for more salty fun on the high seas. In Perfidious, Pete plays XCOM, The Long War 2. Now, ordinarily, when a strange man offers you a little salty fun on the high seas, you should call the authorities immediately. Especially if you're in, like, Nebraska, or if that man identifies himself as Captain anything that could be a euphemism for anal sex. Captain Humps, Captain Thrust, God forbid, Captain Stabbin'. Any of those words should immediately trigger you, put you into a state of alarm, and send you screaming for the nearest phone. That's it. Call the authorities. Somebody right now is going like, well, you know, Pete rhymes with meat, and if Captain Meat is offering me a little salty fun on the high seas, why am I not getting in contact with Chris Hansen and his team at the moment? I don't really have a good reason other than that. You'll just have to trust me that I'm not up to any nefarious hijinks involving your back door. You probably shouldn't trust me, and really, if you were calling the authorities right now, I wouldn't blame you. I mean, I do have Perfidious right there in the name, so trusting me is not a great idea. But I do have no intention of taking you in a very uncomfortable place, be it your butt or the back of a Volkswagen. Just know. I made the nautical reference just because I feel like I'm starting to get my sea legs a little bit in the long war. And unfortunately, thanks to the internet and Captain Stabbin, anything nautical or boat-related is now just inextricably linked to anal sex. That's it. That's the way it works now. It's both inexplicable and inextricable. And those two words are very difficult to say in close succession. The butt sex references are inevitable, even though that's not where I was going with it. And now this intro is entirely derailed. So you know what? The train has come off the rails, it's crashed into an orphanage, and it started a fire, and I'm just going to turn my back on it and walk away like a cool guy, because cool guys don't look at explosions or train wrecks. Rookies Michelle Rodriguez and Chris Brown are in there doing a little shinobi training, by the way, which is fine. We need to get back to scanning, try and finish our liberation. I am going to liberate Eastern United States the same way that Captain Stabbin will liberate you from not knowing what it feels like to have a penis in your rectum. He can liberate you from that. I'm going to liberate this region. It's all about liberation. We're freeing minds and opening horizons. It's a whole new world of, you know, getting fucked in a butt on a boat. I don't know if that's actually a new world so much as maybe a paradigm shift on the old one slightly. All right, Tim Allen picking up Oscar Mike ability. That's excellent. We're just going to throw Tim right back into training, and I'm picking up incoming. Get some is not a terrible ability, I don't think, but given your team plus 20 critical for a turn, it's interesting, but I don't think it's anywhere near as good as Get Down, which has the potential to save your entire team alive if you know you're going to get hit by a grenade. It's vastly better. You don't always know when the grenade is coming, that's true, but you oftentimes can see an enemy who has a grenade and be like, this would be a good time to maybe take precautions. The drunk tank is at 62%. Don Keen, you gonna finish up? Nope, it's go time. So Dr. Donnie Jordan, the only reason we're doing this mission is because it is a liberation mission. We've got moderate heavy enemy activity, which is a shitload. That's a ton of guys. But we have to boost this. We have to. We're gonna pick Donnie Jordan. You're an also-ran. Don't think I'm coming to save you, Donnie. I don't give a shit about you, Donnie. It's not you I'm here for. Mostly because your name is Donnie Jordan, and I don't know which one of the new kids you're actually supposed to be. Are you Donnie Wahlberg or are you Jordan? Which one is it? Make up your mind. We're going to boost this because it's a liberation, and we've got to liberate a region. This is what we were talking about. It has to be done. This is part of our liberation chain. We've got to get a mission liberated at some point, or we're just going to lose to the Doom counter sight unseen. That drops our enemy activity down to light, which is fantastic. They are also vulnerable, which means we should have a pretty good shot at pulling off the stealth run. And that's the only way missions work. I've just come to the paradigm now that any mission that is not like an ambush mission or a supply raid or a mission that is designed to fight, you just cannot fight. If you wind up in a fight on one of these styles of missions on a long enough timeline, you are going to lose. It is unwinnable on one of these missions. And really, if you're fighting at all, you've lost. You should always try and complete the mission without fighting at all. That's the only real way it's going to work and be safe. I'm also starting to think that maybe I'm taking too big of a team. Three people on this mission? It's a very small team, but you know what? We wouldn't have had the boost if we had just sent in one lone Tanya Harding to try and ghostwalk her way to an objective. That's all I'm saying. If it worked for Tom Small Size Sizemore, it ought to work for little Tanya Harding. She should be able to dash in there, smash in Nasty Kerrigan's knee with the, what was it, like a tire iron? With the tire iron? And then get on out of there. All she needs is the tire iron to make that plan work. So we're loading up Operation Falling Dawn any day now, by the way. And at least it's Falling Dawn, not Falling Down. I don't have to Shanghai Michael Douglas into it like a really sort of a bad movie where he finds a duffel bag full of guns and becomes an impromptu vigilante. I mean, he's no Batman, but actually, that movie's pretty bad, now that I think about it. I was going to say that movie's not that bad, but you know what? That movie was dumb. It didn't make a whole lot of sense. The thing that didn't make the most sense, not that I don't buy Michael Douglas as a potential vigilante lunatic, because that, you know, I can see that one. The thing I don't buy about that, he was driving a very Eastern European car in that film. And that's what just doesn't make any sense to me, Perfidious Pete. A guy like that is not going to drive a car that looks like it was built in a former Soviet republic that no longer exists anymore. The kind of car that gets like 15 hectares to a single tank of kerosene, and that when you want to go somewhere, you'd be like, put it in H! No, that's not the kind of car he would drive. He was some kind of defense contractor, man, at the end of the Cold War. He is not driving that kind of ride. Why are you taking first moves with Jared Fogle? Well, there is a reason for that. And that is these civilians right here. I want to have somebody who can take a move that does not risk exposing us, but who is also fast enough to catch up. So going that way seems like a tragically awful idea. So can we slip up the side, maybe up the zone wall here, and get onto the rooftop? Also, how are we going to get into this building? I can't really tell what's going on in the map at all. We need better lines of sight. All right, Tanya Harding, I want you coming up here. Tanya Harding is our least likely person to be detected just because she has the SMG. And really, rather than Jared Fogle, probably the smart move would have been to take that initial run with Fred Durst here. Probably would have been a little smarter. Got it covered. Also, now our team is split up. This is bad. If these guys patrol down the street and Uncle Jared gets pinned into their patrol region, we may find ourselves in a scenario where he just literally is incapable of catching up. And so Uncle Jared, you're going to have to do the long end run back around to catch up with the rest of the team while we go forward at a very cautious clip. I'm really concerned about this edge. We could step on we have no idea what's down there. We could step on a civilian, we could activate a pod. All of those things are terrible. You know what? We need to get vision over there first. Fred, jump down here and don't land on a civilian. For a second, his gremlin appeared under his feet, and I thought he was going to step on it, and I was about to cry. Let's get you down here. This is even risky coming around this corner blind. Okay, Uncle Jared, we need you just... You're just playing catch-up for the rest of the mission. You've already been left behind. It's unfortunate, but we all knew this day was coming. When the rapture came, Uncle Jared, we knew you were getting left below. We all knew it. This is not news to anyone. Okay, Tanya Harding. So, do we have a way to get onto this building? And what are the odds that there's not a pod on that rooftop? It's basically a certainty that there is a pod on that rooftop. I think we're going to have to send Fred and Jared just... Yeah, okay, so there they are right there. I think we're going to have to send Fred and Jared around the outside, like an M&M jam. Oh, God. Uncle Jared's going to get trapped on the roof. And see what I'm talking about with can't fight? This team cannot fight any part of this. They have no chance here. We're going to be stuck. Yeah, I'm really starting to think that on these missions, a one-man team is actually in all ways superior to any other combination of team members. It seems like one guy is way more likely to be able to pull this particular infiltration gig that we're trying. One guy is way more likely to be able to pull this off, right? How the hell are we going to get in this building? The VIP is so far away from the extraction zone. Tanya Harding can go in as a ghost walker. You know what? I don't know if we're going to be able to do this or not. I don't know if we're going to be able to get everybody we need into the positions we need them in time. 10-4. And I think at this point, Fred Durst and Jared Fogle are just trying to escape alive. I think we should just have them go straight to evac. We don't even want them to consider making a move on going into that building. That's just a bad idea. We should just, no, yeah. You know what? We should have them run straight for evac. And we've learned a valuable lesson. On these missions anymore, I'm just sending a shinobi. There's no reason to send more people. There isn't. More people only make it more difficult. We already can't fight, and if we're never going to fight, what we need to do is maximize the chances that we don't have to fight, and Jared Fogle is going to be trapped again. He's going to be in a detection tile. There's no way he can get around. Because he has a shotgun, not an SMG. Also, every enemy in the world is patrolling directly towards him. So, is there any way you can path around here, Jared? No, because you're currently in a detection tile. You can't move without getting spotted. Fantastic. And at this point, we're getting to a situation where Jared may not even be able to make it to the extraction, even if he runs straight towards it. He can't move. Affirmative. We'll just drop him into Overwatch then. We got civilians over there, which is bad. If there's enemies on the rooftop, Tanya Harding is going to get busted, which is bad. We can't afford to spawn a pod and drop our concealment, because that means Jared Fogle is just dead. He's going to get sandwiched by 86 guys and wind up eating a shit sandwich. Moving any further is risky. Staying put is also risky, though. What if these Vipers circle back? Okay, Fred, let's get you up here. And we do need to be in a position with cover against those Vipers in case they circle back. So we're going to put Fred behind this bench. The civilians will not rat on us unless we bump into them. I think this move should be relatively safe. Okay. He says as he inadvertently steps into a detection tile. Nope. There are detection tiles in that room, though. Please patrol away. Thank you. All we need is one tile to slip Uncle Jared past. Yeah, these infiltration missions, then. It's like having dinner with a hermit. The more people that you bring, the worse everything is going to ultimately wind up. You're better off to just come alone. Or just not come at all. But in this case, I think coming alone is probably the better scenario. Yeah, it's damn skippy time to motor, Jared. You got 8 turns and a lot of ground to cover. You need to move your ass. Fred Durst we brought on the mission because he could potentially hack the jail cell, but getting Fred Durst even vision on that is going to be extraordinarily difficult. Tanya Harding, if we bring you around, it seems like it would be easier to just have Tanya Harding go in and pop it. I mean, she can almost get... Wait a minute. Is she not revealed going whatever pathway this is? This says Tanya Harding is not revealed. How does she do that? How is she pathing? Is there... There's a hatch. Got it. Do I want to get that aggressive with my boys so far apart? I mean, it is an aggressive move, and what if there are guys in the building? And odds are pretty strong there are probably guys in that building. You know what? Let's hold off on that one turn. We've still got enough time that we can buy another turn with Tanya Harding if we need it. She's really fast. Okay, it's a damn good thing we took the extra turn then, isn't it? Otherwise, this would have ended in tragedy and everyone would be dead. Everyone was... Oh my god, there's a robot right fucking there on the roof. Holy shit, pickles. Also, look at this pod, by the way. The pod camping the objective? This is ridiculous. There is no way if that pod doesn't patrol that we can complete this mission. Because we cannot get that man out of jail... And to the extraction point. And even if we can get him out of jail, he's never going to survive the run to safety. It's just, it's not going to happen. I want Fred Dursk and Uncle Jared at the evac point before we even make an attempt. Yes, please go outside, gentlemen, and continue. The drawback now is we have no idea where those guys actually are. We could try and ghostwalker our way in. Jared, please don't get pinned. Don't get pinned. Don't get pinned. Jared Fogle and the rest of the team are making this so much harder right now. It's so much harder because they're here. Okay, Fred, I sincerely think the best move here might just be to have Durst extract. That might straight up be our best move. We could ghost walk Tanya Harding to the objective right now. We ghost walk her in. She's next to the cell. She could also hack it this turn. The question is, where did that fucking robot go? Is there anybody in this room? This is what we actually need to know. Yep. There's a guy on the stairs? Maybe? I just want to see if there are any tiles we can't stand in. Because if there's a tile we can't stand in, that means there's a dude in it. It doesn't look like it. One turn too early? It feels one turn too early. Let's wait. Fred Durst, I want you up here. You know what, Fred? I don't want you up there. I want you in the extraction zone, actually. I'm not going to extract Fred yet. Tanya Harding next turn is going to ghost walk to the objective. This turn, she's just going to overwatch. Fred, let's just end it. We probably squandered our opportunity then. Those guys came back. I don't know if there's any chance if we can ghost walk to the roof. That would have been our turn to do it right there. If we ghost walk, are we going to be able to shrink the detection tiles enough to pull this off? The answer is no, we cannot. But we could, I mean, we've got enough time that we could wait one more turn. Tanya Harding, I think, can make the extraction zone from where she's standing right now. But we're going to need at least two turns. Yeah, Tanya Harding can actually make the extraction zone from here, so there's no drawback into just waiting. Let's bide our time. Fred, Overwatch. This also gives Jared a chance to get closer to extraction. If only we could fight on these missions, I might consider trying to take a shot at these guys. The robot is back on the rooftop. That's fantastic. Fred, you're still fine where you're at. Jared, I need you to get to extraction because you're bringing absolutely nothing to the table. And the fact right now, you are... I don't want to say this, Jared Fogel. I hate to say this, but right now, you are a liability. Jared Fogel is a liability, especially if you're advertising delicious sandwiches. He's definitely going to be a liability. Yep, this is bad. How many more turns can we... If these guys go off the side of the building... I really wish I could tell where the rest of that team was. Can we use the mouse trick to tell if any of these guys are in a tile? We gotta know if they're... Okay, we're gonna... I can't believe I'm sweeping like this. This feels so chintzy and lame. But we're on the clock, and the clock is running. Is there a guy there? There might be a guy there, or that might be... Because I think that's a table. Okay. Fogel. I kind of just want you to extract. Instead, I'm going to have you overwatch against my better judgment. Fred, I want you to overwatch against my better judgment. And this is our moment. Tanya Harding, engage Ghostwalker. It's now or never, girl. Let's do this. Get to the cell. Headed there now. We're either going to pull this off or we're sunk. The Ghostwalker was enough. Those guys are patrolling away. As long as we don't reveal ourselves, I kind of feel like maybe we've got enough time. I'm going to go on Overwatch and rely on the fact that these guys are patrolling away. This is either the smartest thing I've ever done or complete and total act of idiocy. Could be a little of column A, could be a little of column B, but now we have got to go. So Tanya Harding, you're hacking this door, even though Fred Durst is definitely probably the better option for this. You're doing it. This is going to cost Tanya an action. Resistance broadcast. One new rebel joins the Haven. He's a fucking faceless, we already know. You know, I feel like Fred Durst probably would have accomplished that, but he's not here. I'm in. We're spotted. Yeah, I know we're spotted. Menace 1-5 status confirmed. Okay, the enemy, technically, it sounds like has reaction moves here, but... How did you see us? Through a fucking wall? That's horse shit. That robot is a tragic awfulness. Okay, so Tanya Harding should still have an action. She does. Where can you run to? You can barely make it to the roof. Can you see anybody from that tile? Nope. Well, if we put you there, though, Jimmy the Scientist has no chance of escape. Actually, Jimmy the Scientist's chances of escape are looking pretty goddamn slim at any rate. All right, Donnie Jordan, move your shapely ass. Jared can't see anything. Fred Durst can't see anything. We could put these guys on Overwatch and theoretically get maybe something out of it, or possibly change the way the enemies will behave sight unseen. Alternatively, what we could do is have Fred Durst throw a fucking... not a flashbang. Oh, Fred Durst, you don't have a smoke grenade? I thought I gave you a smoke grenade. Okay, well, Jared, come over here. Okay. Be in full cover. And also be on Overwatch. Fred, be on Overwatch. And we just cross our fingers here. This is the best we can do. Keep your... oh, fingers crossed for little Tanya Harding. Dicks out for Harambe. Fingers crossed for Tanya Harding. Somebody just got shot at. That guy jumped onto the roof. Jared Fogle took a shot at him. So did Fred and whiffed. Just don't drop me through the ceiling with a bomb. That's all I ask. Tanya Harding was criticaled because of course she was. Oh, she's dead then. If this guy gets a shot, she's dead. Yep. Up. There was nothing else we could do. Sacrifices have to be made. Can't break taken. Oh, God. Tanya Harding had our fucking Predator armor on. That's the only reason the first fucking critical didn't kill her. She had a... just go.
VIP secure and in position for evac.
This is Firebrand. VIP is secure.
I'm out of here.
This mission would have been so much easier with just one person. It really would have. We lost a suit of armor, although honestly, armor at this point feels fucking pointless. No fight in these scenarios is ever winnable anyway.
Status confirmed. Mission accomplished.
Rating acceptable. Yeah, no. We're never doing a stealth mission with more than one person ever again. Everybody else we bring on those missions is nothing but a liability. People are like, you should bring one specialist. You know, I'm not entirely sold on that. I'm really not. Well, Tanya Harding had the master plan, and apparently her master plan was get killed while wielding equipment. See, this is one... okay, this is... I'm going to take a minute to rant here about Long War II and why I think it has made some very poor choices. When your best opportunity for a tactical mission like this is to send in one shinobi with a SMG and no gear and no hope of fighting the enemy, when your best plan is to send one person with no upgrades and nothing because they might get killed by an overwhelming level of opposition that you have no hope of stopping, that's a design flaw. It is. The best way to do a stealth mission or any of these missions is not to send an actual team and ever engage in combat. It's to send in one shinobi and just hope you can do it without ever being spotted. This is not a tactical game. This is a management game entirely. And if it is, that's fine. Build a management game. Don't make me go on missions then. Just let me train up one person and send them and leave them on their merry way. I would have abandoned this mission entirely if it wasn't a liberation, but the gear loss really fucking kicks us in the balls because now we have no advanced armor. Not that that's going to matter anyway. Basically, we're looking at one-hit kills at this point, regardless of what armor we're wearing. Tanya Harding got shot twice and criticaled both times. It's not like there's anything else we could have done to keep her alive because that robot would have destroyed her cover with a grenade and she'd have got shot 40 times if we didn't try to run out of line of sight. Do I sound salty? It's because I'm really salty. Somebody got killed, but more importantly, we lost gear. Those are supplies we're never getting back. It really feels like even giving them weapon upgrades is just stupid. It's objectively a bad idea. If you're sending one guy in, why send him in with anything? Maybe protective gear like armor is all you'd really want to do, but honestly, I feel like maybe a chameleon suit is going to be the smarter. One shinobi in a chameleon suit with an SMG, a shape charge, and nothing else. That's every infiltration mission from now on, because it's the paradigm that has the most opportunity for success. I'm super salty. Run and gun cooldown is reduced by one turn. That's really good. We love run and gun. Aggression is always at least plus 5% of a critical chance, but with killer instinct, aggression feels less necessary. Formidable is garbage. They should just say take extra conditioning at this level then, because you're always going to. If you have killer instinct, you're taking it. And Tanya Harding has been killed. You got... Okay, this is your moment, Donnie Jordan. I'm sitting you down in front of the tank. You know what, Jordan? Earn this. Earn it. You hear me? Earn it. You gotta earn this. Research time increased by... Decreased, rather, by 17%. I feel super salty about that. I'm pretty sure... We did lose a Sten gun. I'm pretty sure she had one. Let's just go take a look down at the... build items. Weapons. Does it tell me how many I have? I still have 3 Sten guns, but I think I built another one. Laser Lance. We have one of those, so it's clearly not reporting the numbers that we... Oh, no, that's a laser cannon. Laser Lance is the sniper rifle. I don't want that. So we have 3 Sten guns, 2, 3 laser rifles, 1 laser cannon, 1 scatter ray. Do I want to spend 20 supplies to build it back? You know, what did the Predator armor actually cost us there? Oh, God, 30 supplies is a ton. Do we build another thing of Predator armor? You know what? I kind of feel like the answer is no. Maybe we build one. Yeah, we're going to have to... Okay, we got to replace it. I have a plan, and the plan henceforth is just we're sending in Tom Sizemore. On any infiltration mission, it's going to be one shinobi. That's our goal. We're going to send in a shinobi by themselves with probably some upgraded armor to help them increase their survivability. An SMG, a shape charge, and literally nothing else. There is no reason to send a team into any of those missions with any intent to fight because you can't fight. You can't do it. You can't get a big enough team in to make fighting viable. Or if you do send in a big team, you're going to be mired in reinforcements so much that you can never actually achieve the objective. Why make me go on them at all? One shinobi on a stealth mission is not a tactical gameplay. It's just hope you don't step in a detection tile. That's really all it is. Avoid civilians. It's a pathing game. Super salty. And I'm done. If you enjoyed the episode, feel free to drop a like down in the comment section. Support really means a lot. If you'd like to see our touching eulogy for Tanya Harding, because for once, you know what, Harding? She deserved it. She deserved it. You might consider subscribing as well, because that'll be next episode. Right now, thanks very much for watching. I'll see you again soon. Sucks that she's dead, but I just wish she hadn't pulled that armor down screaming into hell with her. Couldn't she have left the armor, Tanya Harding? Why do you have to bring everybody else around you? Why do you got to drag everyone else down?